The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department also hopeful Indonesia will soon pardon Filipino death row convict Mary Jane Veloso. Early last week, Veloso's family traveled to Yogyakarta to visit Veloso for the first time since the pandemic. But the Foreign Affairs Department says it has not received an update from Jakarta over the country's appeal for clemency for Veloso. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on the sidelines of the ASEAN summit last month urged his Indonesian counterpart Joko Widodo to re-examine Veloso's case.
Sumulat na ang ating mahal na Pangulo kay President Widodo naman ng Indonesia para humingi ng clemency para sa ating kababayan. At dahil nga nahatulan na siya ng death penalty. At hopefully, magkaroon ng konting galaw. Dahil hanggang sa ngayon, wala pang desisyon o linaw ang request natin kay President Widodo na i-convert na lang o na clemency, humingi ng clemency o patawad dito.
Veloso has been jailed in Indonesia since 2010 after she was caught with 2.6 kilograms of drugs in her suitcase. Her execution in 2015 was stopped following the arrest of her recruiters. Three convicted Filipinos received pardon from the United Arab Emirates. According to Malacanang, two of the Filipinos were on death row for drug trafficking, while the third was handed down a 15-year sentence for slander. The palace says Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos was the one who shared the news to Marcos, who called UAE President Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan to express his gratitude for supposedly granting the request the Philippine leader made 2 months ago. Manila's Foreign Affairs Department says the repatriation of the three Filipinos is now being worked out. Three gang leaders from the Philippine State Penitentiary pled guilty for being accessories in the murder of radio man Percy Lapid. According to Lapid's brother Roy Mabasa, Alas Piñas Court sentenced inmates Aldrin Galicia, Alvin Labra, and Alfie Peña Redonda to imprisonment of up to 8 years. The Philippine Justice Department welcomes this development. But the agency adds it is not stopping there and it would like to see the brains behind the murder of Lapid and the alleged middleman to his assassination, June Villamor, plead guilty or convicted. The alleged mastermind, former corrections chief Gerald Bantag, and his deputy Ricardo Zulueta remain at large. Authorities have put a 3 million peso reward for information that will lead to their capture. Lapid was fatally shot outside a subdivision in Las Piñas in October last year. The Philippine Central Bank has a new head. The palace announced Friday President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s appointment of Eli Remolona as the successor to outgoing Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla. Remolona has been a member of the BSP's Monetary Board since August 2022. He brings with him 14 years of experience from the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. Before joining the BSP, Remolona also served as independent director of the Bank of the Philippine Islands. He will begin his six-year term after Medalla steps down on July 2. The palace says Remolona is expected to steer the central bank in promoting financial stability and implementing effective monetary policies. Outgoing Philippine Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla welcoming the appointment of Eli Remolona as his successor. Medalla says Remolona is fully capable of leading BSP. Medalla also extended his gratitude to President Marcos for giving him the chance to serve as BSP governor. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno also approving the appointment, citing Remolona's experience in monetary policy. Meanwhile, the Bankers Association of the Philippines said in a statement, it is confident that Remolona will anchor the Philippine banking industry towards growth in the regional stage. The warden of the Malabon City Jail relieved from his post after inmates protest alleged mistreatment. The inmates held a noise barrage and broke windows as they held up signs highlighting complaints against the food and the jail system. The BJMP and the local government of Malabon City say they're now addressing the issue. The Alliance of Concerned Teachers condemned the Philippine Education Department's alleged profiling operation. That's after a supposed June 14 memorandum from the agency ordering local offices to submit a list of ACT-affiliated teachers. ACT Chairperson Vladimir Kitua called the move harassment. He warned the alleged profiling could lead to red tagging of members. According to Kitua, one of the factors that could have led to the memo is the group's complaint to the International Labor Organization, which they filed back in April over the alleged red tagging statements of the DepEd.
Tama lang naman kaming humingi ng tulong kasi wala kaming mapakinggan eh. Wala kaming makuha ng justisya sa loob ng bansa. Kaya tingin namin may karapatan naman ang International Labor Organization na tingnan din, reviewin din at magbigay ng mga tinatawag nating mga tandas, no, o mga panuto.
The Education Department meanwhile asserts the memo is purely in relation to the agency's so-called automatic payroll deduction system.
Ang assurance lang namin, no, hindi ito profiling. This is not in any way related to profiling of members of certain organizations, but this is just purely in relation to our APDS. Wala dapat ipangambang ating mga miyembro ng anumang organisasyon na ito ay isang profiling mechanism ng departamento. We will never go into that purpose.
An expert from the Philippine Department of Science and Technology recommends reducing the area covered by the fishing ban in the province of Oriental Mindoro. Scientist Dr. Hernando Bacosa says the prohibited area can be slashed to 5 kilometers from 15 kilometers. Bacosa was tapped to help authorities with oil spill cleanup efforts. He adds the total fishing ban can be lifted if there are no visible oil slicks near the spill site. In February 2023, a fuel tanker ran aground off Oriental Mindoro while carrying over 800,000 liters of oil. There is still a fishing ban in Calapan City and three other towns in Oriental Mindoro. The Philippine Treasury Bureau assures the public funds intended for social services will not be used as seed money for the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund. Job Manahan joins us on the line for more on that. Job, good afternoon. What can you tell us about this?
Rica, good afternoon. The Bureau of Treasury assured the public that the controversial Maharlika Investment Fund won't touch government's budget for social services. National Treasurer Rosalia De Leon clarified, while 50 billion of the fund's capital would come from the government, this would not tap the budget for social programs. De Leon adds, government could also fund the MIF through proceeds from privatization and transfer of public assets. Based on the approved version of Congress, the Maharlika Fund will have an initial capital of 500 billion from the central bank, gaming revenues, and two government-owned banks. Experts fear, however, there could still be a loophole for the proposed investment fund to dip into public's money, which in turn could impact budget for government projects. Rica President Marcos this week said he would sign the proposed law creating the country's first sovereign wealth fund as soon as it reaches his office. The president said he would still need to look into the changes made in the Congress-approved version, which he said should be independent from government to become successful. Rica.
Job, I just have one question. Was the national treasurer asked of what the safeties were in on the Maharlika Fund bill that they're saying makes them think that the bill is not keen into any forms of misuse or maltreatment? I was curious because some lawmakers are actually questioning this.
Yes, Rica, what she told us earlier is that there are initial funding for the Maharlika Investment Fund, and these funds would come from, for example, here, it would come from different government financing institutions, such as the Land Bank of the Philippines and the Development Bank of the Philippines. And she said that there would be independent directors and independent financial managers who would look and monitor the Maharlika Investment Fund and how this is being or how these operations or how Maharlika Corporation is doing its operations.
Mm-hmm. All right, with that, I will let you go. Job Manahan reporting live. Thank you so much. The Philippine and Australian armies wrap up their joint drills in Tanay, Rizal on Friday. The two armies exchanged skills in various scenarios such as urban operations and jungle warfare. Bianca Dava reports.
The Philippines and Australia concluded on Friday the second phase of this year's army-to-army exercise, dubbed Kasanga, which means partners. In the past 3 weeks, 174 soldiers from the Philippine Army and Australian Defense Force took part in urban operations and jungle warfare drills at Camp Kapinpin in Tanay, Rizal. The soldiers also trained in long-range marksmanship and tactical combat casualty care, among others.
Each of our armies have our respective strengths. And when we share this with the other army, We also increase the competence and the capacity of these armies, of the other army, to operate in these kinds of environment that we are facing, especially when we talk about threats that we are facing in the region. So, and it's not just the man-made threats, but also the natural threats that we are facing.
With the conclusion of the Kasanga exercise, a message is being sent that both armies are together in their objective to prevent war in the Indo-Pacific region. 2nd Infantry Division Commander Major General Roberto Capulong said Filipino troops gained knowledge and skills from their Australian counterpart, especially on close-quarter combat.
We have done all that we can. We made sure that first they have a good place to stay. We prepared a billeting just for them. During the exercise, we made sure that we made all available facilities so that we can maximize the benefit of the exercise. The greater benefits was actually received by us because most of the training that we had, it was done by the Australian for the Filipinos.
Australian Assistant Defense Attaché to the Philippines, Lieutenant Colonel Tim Lopsik, said Australian troops also learned so much about jungle warfare and survival from their Filipino counterparts.
Our soldiers have an opportunity to learn a significant amount about the conduct of jungle war fighting. We have an opportunity to share lessons learned as about the different exposures we've had to conflict and warfare.
The Philippines has a Status of Visiting Forces Agreement with Australia, signed in 2007, which allows the conduct of joint exercises and high-level visits. According to Philippine Army Commanding General, Lieutenant General Romeo Browner Jr., the armies of the Philippines and Australia still have one more joint exercise this year, the Dawn and Dusk Kuracha, which will be conducted in Fort Magsaysay, Nueva Ecija. The Philippine Army will also have joint military drills with their counterparts from Malaysia and Indonesia by the third quarter of the year. Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News.
Oil prices may be headed higher next week. After a slight rollback last week, estimates show motorists would have to pay at least 90 centavos more for a liter of diesel. Kerosene may also see a 1 peso markup. As for gasoline, prices are expected to either remain unchanged or rise by 30 centavos.